So I'm very happy to be here. I mean, this is, we tried last year, but I couldn't make it, and I'm here today. And I want to thank the organizer, I want to thank Alex, I want to thank Marion and all the presenters. For us, it's very important to have events like this, and I really like Hack.lu, so I'm very happy to be here and to present what we do in ENISA. So how many of you know ENISA first? One, two, oh wow, I'm very happy. So for those who don't know ENISA, ENISA is the EU Cybersecurity Agency. So what we do? Well, today I will try to give you a 101 of what we do. We do a lot of stuff, and we cover a lot of topics. The idea here is to cover a little bit of infrastructure, security, and resilience, but okay, we will see if we have time to go a little bit further. So I will introduce you with about ENISA, and then we will deep dive on infrastructure. And I want to present you three studies that we are doing this year, we are going to publish soon. One is about threat modeling for SCADA. Another one is about threat modeling for smart cars, the cars you use every day. And another one is about airports. I don't know how many of you came here with airports, but there are security, cybersecurity challenge also there. And then finally, I will try to engage you and tell you how you can work with us and help us secure Europe Information Society. Because this is what we do. So our mission is to secure Europe Information Society. But what is Europe Information Society? Europe Information Society is you. 500 million of citizens that use mobile phones. You have electricity at home, I believe, smart grids maybe. You have smart TV, you have home domotic appliances. You use the internet. We have about 330 million of people who are actually using internet a lot during the week. And we have a lot of attack surface. So our job, and this is why ENISA was created in 2004, is to help raise the cybersecurity issue. We need to tell people that there are cybersecurity challenges to face. So this is why the European Union created in 2004 ENISA, the EU Cybersecurity Agency. We are an independent body under European law. We are based in Greece, in Athens. Headquarters are in Heraklion, but operations from which I belong to is in Athens. And we serve all the 28 member states. We work with cybersecurity agencies in all the member states, cybersecurity researchers, operator of critical infrastructure, security researcher, academia. Our job is to enable a higher level of cybersecurity in Europe. Because the more we use information communication technology, the more we have attack surface, and we need to mitigate this. But not everybody was training for cybersecurity, so this is why we created ENISA. And our role is exactly this, to be the hub for information exchange, to be the facilitator, to be the enabler of cybersecurity. How we do it? Well, this is a little bit of introduction. I don't know how many of you know that we publish studies. Up to now, we published 250 studies. This year, we will publish 45 studies around something like this. I will not talk about all of them today, only three, but I can give you insight also to the other. But the idea here is that we cover the entire spectrum of cybersecurity. So today, the focus is about infrastructure, critical infrastructure, smart infrastructure, but we cover encryption, we cover computer emergency response team, we cover cybersecurity preparedness, awareness. We do a lot of work in providing tools and study for information exchange from CERTs. And basic e-health, so everything you can think about, there is a cybersecurity challenge, we probably have a study or we are about to do one. But this is only one part of the stuff that we do. Because the study is one thing, but we mobilize community. So this is why I'm here today. And this is why we also organize a lot of workshops and events. Last week, for example, I organized an event about security of smart cars in Munich. And next week, we are in Stockholm, opening, having an open session in 4S ICS, which is a SCADA conference. And we also have a closed meeting for our stakeholders. But I will tell you more. Go on our website, for the topics, you can go enisa.europa.eu/topics and you will find all the topics, and /events, you will find all the events. So as I said, studies, events, and community engagement, because we go and present as today I'm here, we organize event and workshop, and also we have a lot of reference group. So we like to have a vertical approach, and I will go more into this later, but basically we try to reach out to cybersecurity leading experts in every field. Can be cars, can be SCADA, intelligent public transport, e-health, and we try to create a reference group that can tell us where are the cybersecurity threats and what we can do as ENISA. Because as ENISA, we have this unique point of view. We are the European Union agency, so we can deal with everybody in all the member states and put all the people around the table, talking about IoT security or smart health, smart hospital, airports, in order to understand what we can do to secure our citizens, our infrastructure and industry. So we said study, community engagement, but also training. If you go on our website, you will find virtual machine for computer incident response team training. You will also find documentation that you can download. Or if you are a national cert, you can invite us to give you training to train the trainers and then scale the knowledge for incident response within your country. But this is only one of the stuff. Another one is Cyber Europe. How many of you participated in Cyber Europe last week? I know some of them, we have people. Excellent. So Cyber Europe is the biggest cybersecurity exercise in Europe. Last week we had 300 organizations from all Europe, private, public, academia, cybersecurity agency, computer emergency response team, who worked together on preparedness scenario in case of large scale incidents. There is a lot of material available, there is a video, there is a lot of stuff, there will be a post exercise study, and you will see how we are prepared to face large scale incidents in Europe. So this was a global effort with 300 organizations. Everything started in April, and last week we had the final part. And we will have in the future also other exercises like this. But also we have the Cybersecurity Challenge, the European Cybersecurity Challenge. 4 years ago this was only an idea, and now we have the finals in Germany next month. So this is very important for us to reach out to the community, to do hands-on training, to give you the opportunity to work with us to test your preparedness in case of large-scale incidents. Finally, we have policy implementation. Sometimes people think that ENISA does policy. We don't do policy, we do policy implementation. So when there is a policy, like for example, the Telecom Framework Directive that in 2009 was obliging telco operators to report large-scale incidents affecting the availability of communication. So for example, if one country, 20 million people, cannot access mobile telephony or internet, they have to report to ENISA, to the member states, and then member states to ENISA and the commission, and we try to understand why this happens. So 2 weeks ago, we published, as we do every year, a study where you can find all the biggest incidents in Europe to see the causes and to see what is the trend in the last 4 years. So it's a very interesting study because it's a report that we already have several years, and you can see the trend of what are the large-scale incidents affecting telco in Europe. Another policy is the Network Information Security Directive, which entered into force in August 2016. We will support the Commission and the Member States to implement this. We will give them everything they ask in terms of tools, study, and we will help them to raise the bar of security in Europe for the operator of essential services and support the Cooperation Network and the CSERT Network. So this was just a one-on-one about ENISA activities. As you can see, it's not only studies, it's workshop, it's hands-on, it's training, it's cybersecurity exercise, cybersecurity challenges where you can work, and it support the member state and the commission. Before going on a little bit, I just wanted to wish you a happy Cybersecurity Month. This year is October, is the Cybersecurity Month. We have a lot of activity around Europe, and I invite you to think about something that you can do in your country next year regarding Cybersecurity Month, because this is very important and can help really to raise the bar of security awareness, not only for the expert in the room, but for the wider population, which they don't have like cybersecurity as their first point in the agenda. So take a look at the activities on cybersecuritymonth.eu in your country and think about what you can do next year. And now let me introduce you to what we do in my unit. So my unit is secure infrastructure and services, and we cover what are the core infrastructure, the backbone of the society and industry in Europe. So the idea here is to really to understand the attack surface and mapping what are the threats for the different industry and the different critical sector of essential sector for the life of the citizen of Europe. We have a vertical approach. So we started to identification of what is critical, because not everything is critical, and only what is defined as critical and has an impact on the life and well-being of society can be defined as this. And then we work on critical information infrastructure and internet infrastructure. For this, I will not cover during this talk, but you can go on our website and you will find that we published 2 years ago the first threat landscape of the internet infrastructure, where you can find everything can happen and what are the mitigation. Because our line of work is this. We try to understand, to tackle one specific sector, one specific area. We do the threat modeling and then we do the good practice and the recommendation to raise the bar. So as I said, critical information infrastructure, internet infrastructure, and then we started in 2011 talking about smart grids. A lot of people, smart grids is the next generation grid, and we already have a lot of implementation in Europe, and we wanted to understand what is the attack surface there. Last year, for example, we published a study about communication network dependencies, where you can find what is the perimeter and what are the attacks, the threats, and the mitigation. And the idea here is to have an ongoing effort together with the operators of smart grids, the commission, in order to have a well-organized cybersecurity posture. We also do this for energy at large, and I will present you one study this year that we are going to publish. So I said we tackle first the network infrastructure, which is a core underlying critical information infrastructure. Then we moved to smart grids. And then last year we started to look into transport. So because if you took a train and you had wayfinding services on an airplane, there are cybersecurity challenges and threats also connected to the use of this transport infrastructure. Because the more we go smart, the more the attacker goes smarter. So we need to identify what are the threats there and to help the asset owners which were not trained for cybersecurity and don't have security by design in mind. For this reason, today I will introduce you to cars and airports. Then we work since 2010 on SCADA. SCADA for us is transversal. So basically is transversal to the underlying oil, gas, industry, health, all the infrastructures. For here, we have worked a lot and I will present you a little bit more. And then we have e-health and smart hospital. I really like the presentation, the first presentation today about hacking Bluetooth, because this is something wearables and e-health devices is something that we will look in the future. And then we have finance. So everything I'm saying you can find on our website. What I will present you today are the efforts that are not yet there, because we are doing them now, and are those for the infrastructure. As I said, we are going to publish around 40 studies. So this is only a glimpse of what we are doing, focus on the infrastructure. So we are going to publish a study about security requirements for electricity. As I said, we work on smart, we work on electricity today, and another one about information sharing in the energy sector. And then today I will go a little bit more in detail on what we do about the attack surface coming from SCADA, from airports and cars. You have to understand that as ENISA, we have this unique point of view where we can tackle both technical and organizational and policy issue. So our studies can be to asset owners, to researchers, but also to governments, to the commission, to the member states. So we can assess what is the situation at national level, and we can go deeper on a more technical level. This is what, for example, we do for SCADA. For SCADA, we started trying to analyze what was the posture of Europe and how we were prepared for attacks to ICS and SCADA in 2011. And from them, there, we published a lot of studies. Some of them were more technical, like, for example, how to face postmortem, how to do incident response, how to disclose vulnerability, how to patch a system, or, for example, how to develop a testing capability in Europe. Other ones were more targeting to member states. So, for example, last year, we published a study about maturity levels of European member states. So we have 28 member states. Some of them have cybersecurity agency, which they have ICS SCADA unit, where they do trainings, audit, they do good practice. Other countries, they are not yet there. So my goal, our goal, is to bring up all the countries to speed, to have an aligned level of cybersecurity regarding SCADA. Doing this, we do this with our stakeholders. So we have two group of experts. One is the ENISA ICS stakeholder group, where we have world leading expert in SCADA, and we try to understand from them where we have to go. And another one is EuroSCASI, which is an information exchange for critical infrastructure operator and cybersecurity agency. Well, we hope not to use much, but in theory, is the idea is to use to disclose vulnerability to critical infrastructure in order to mitigate them and to patch or face large-scale incidents. So everything I say about SCADA is on our website. Today I will talk about you what we are doing this year. We are about to publish soon. So this is communication network dependency for SCADA. And basically the idea here was to map the attack surface and all the assets and threats in order to help operators of critical infrastructure to understand the kind of attack they have to face and how they can mitigate them. So the idea here, we started talking with our experts in order to narrow down what was the perimeter and the protocols. And for this, we tried to cover the entire perimeter using ISA 95 and all the possible protocols that can be involved. So the idea here is really to map exactly the attack surface at all the level in order to really help asset owners and operators to understand what kind of threats and what kind of mitigation action they can put in place to secure the network assets, because here we have dependencies. We have dependencies, vertical dependency between the different layers, from the sensor to the business processes, but also we have external interdependency. But because when I talk about SCADA, I talk about components of operator of critical infrastructure, oil, gas, water, industry. So an attack to a specific component can have cascading effects for external interdependencies. So an attack to a component in one infrastructure can have consequences and cascading effect to another infrastructure. It can be physical, can be in the same country or in another country. So our work is exactly this: to understand and map all the interdependency, help asset owner to understand what this interdependency can mean for those infrastructure that are relying on this infrastructure, and help them to mitigate what is the attack surface. How we do this? We do this going to them. We go there to interview asset owners and operators to understand what are their threats, how they do the work, what kind of security measures they put in place. So for this, what we do, we try to understand and get the pulse a little bit of what are the threats they face more. And you can see here, these are the threats that we listed as the most important for them. You can see here a lot of the topics that we discussed today. So we were discussing about malware, how we can infect SCADA, and this is a very high likelihood, and the impact can be very high because we can compromise a lot of systems and have cascading effects. We talk about exploits, we talk about APTs. Another topic that we wanted to cover and was insider threats. So how this can affect infrastructure operators. And then we have the usual eavesdropping, communication dependency, and this is why a network attack, for example, on one telco operator that is supporting one operator of critical infrastructure that can have cascading effects. And then we have DDoS and information leakage. Everything here is to provide a tool provide documents and study that the people who are securing these assets can use in their everyday risk assessment. They can use to go to the top manager, because we know how to face threats, but we have to educate the top manager, we have to educate the rest of our enterprise, and also we have to help OT people and IT people to work together for cybersecurity, for safety. So we really need to join forces to provide them with tools, documents that can use, because this is a list of the attack scenarios that you can envision, because there are several attack scenarios, and in the study we try to map them all against every kind of asset in this system. And this year we also introduce a new part in our methodology. We also run a proof of concept. So not only we try to list all the assets, all the threats, all the connection between assets and threats, the likelihood, the impact, what operators are facing, are more scared about. But we also give you the list of all the possible attacks, and then we go deeper, one step deeper, and we give you an end-to-end proof of concept regarding the most scary compromise, which is in the incidents that can happen. That in this case, we have SCADA consistent compromise, the insider threats that can take advantage of the situation, and then the malware infection. So the idea here is really to provide a document and a study that covers all the difficult or the different aspects from a tech point of view and also from a good practice point of view. Because when we talk about with operators, we understand that not always something that we assume, as we assume that staff shouldn't be exposed on Shodan, something they are not so clear also for all the actors involved. So for this reason, we publish good practice when we try to list all the possible countermeasures and all the possible action they have to take into account. And finally, since we can have this kind of recommendation, we also provide recommendation at a higher level, let's say a CEO and a board member level and a European Commission or member states, in order to raise the bar of security. So how to work not only on the technical stuff, but on the second level, on the organizational stuff, how to really to raise the bar. So how to put security in the business life cycle, how to really to work on the awareness, on the training on the people, how to really consider cybersecurity as a part of the core operations, and to really provide not only guidelines for the people who are directly taking care of the CISO team or part of the CISO team or the security team, but also how to go to the top managers and tell them that security should be part of the life cycle, that is one of the core components, should be considered by design, and should be part of the corporate governance. So this is something that we really try to use our work to raise light to on this kind of topics, which are not only technical, but also organizational. Because when we talk about a training skill set, when talking about awareness raising, this is not merely technical, but it's organizational. It's a change of mindset that we need. Because if you are going to use this infrastructure for the life of society, we need really to put security as one of the core elements. And this is only for SCADA. So as I said, transversal to various infrastructure. But last year, we also started to work on the transport infrastructure. Many of you may have heard about smart city or the intelligent public transport. But what this means? So basically, the smart components is a data exchange on top of legacy infrastructure. And we really need to help these stakeholders, which are like working together at different levels, to understand what are the risks in enabling the smart component, the wayfinding services, a more seamless passenger experience. And we have to do this at different level, because when we talk about smart city and transport, we talk about not only the transport operator, but the municipalities, the policymakers. So we need to talk to different level of audience. And also we talk about manufacturer and vendor. So we need really to tailor our message for this. So for this reason, last year we published two studies. This is already there, where you can find a little bit what is the cybersecurity challenges and the architecture for smart city and the, what is the threat modeling for intelligent public transport. And this was the initial step on transport infrastructure. So based on this, as you can see, we have a vertical approach. We decided to go further and to go to cover other components. So this year, we decided to cover smart cars. When I talk about smart cars, I don't talk about autonomous vehicles. I don't talk about vehicle to infrastructure. I talk about the smart cars you are driving today. The one with a lot of ECU and TCU inside now. The one that has created now an increased attack surface. Those that until now didn't include cybersecurity in the life cycle, in design life cycle. Those that where we have a lot of incidents. Up to now, okay, the Miller-Valasek is one of the most important, but we have a lot of examples, and up to now, we calculated there is like 100 million cars that are exposed in a way or another. So we really need to talk about a security culture, a cybersecurity culture, to talk about what is the liability and what is the integration between safety and security. Because car manufacturers up until now were concerned about safety. Security is the new item in the agenda. Only with the recall, only with the big news on the newspaper, we are starting to talk about what is the cybersecurity component on safety. And also, we need to put cybersecurity in the supply chain. So, for this reason, this year we started to look into this. As I said, last week we had a workshop, the final validation workshop in Munich with experts from all Europe. And we are going to publish this study in the coming months. And the idea here is was, as we did, for example, for SCADA, for operator of critical infrastructure, to map the attack surface, to map the communication dependency that can be internal, because modern cars are composed by many embedded electronic control units or telematic control units, and we have internal interdependency, but also we have external interdependencies, because we make really there is a lot of attack surface, both internally and externally. I don't know if some of you have read the Cars Hacker Handbook, but there is a lot of stuff that can be exploited. We know the Valasek Miller, we know their example, but the idea here is really what we wanted to do is to define a baseline threat modeling for smart cars, the first of its kind, where we can start to build upon for the future challenges. Because the smart cars that we are covering in these studies are those ones that you are driving to today is the attack surface that you can exploit now. And the idea here was really to map everything and to provide car manufacturer, tier one, tier two, and aftermarket vendors with a complete overview of the different cybersecurity challenges. Because we have a lot of threats coming from both internal and external attack surface. And we need to understand how to face this, how to put cybersecurity by design in the car manufacturer culture. So because we have lack of communication protection from the point of view of the design of the internal components, the identification, the authentication, the authorization, and we really need to work also on external component diagnostic, because I can go to a garage, I can plug, I can get access to the CAN bus, I can jam messages. So there is a lot of stuff to do, and there is a lot of different stakeholders that are working in this environment. So we really need to understand what are the issues at stake, provide them with a list of all the possible threats, and start from there to build a cybersecurity culture for automotive in Europe, where we can have cybersecurity researchers that disclose vulnerability, where we have an open dialogue on how to make automotive cybersecurity together, and where we can work for cybersecurity for safety. So, as we did for the other study, also here, we work on mapping the threats and then providing what are the attack scenarios. That can be from remote attack, from network exposure, con asset effects that can be external communication, ECU, and sensor, or internal. So basically, when I physically connect to by as I am my owner of my car, and I physically connect to the car infrastructure, or buy the diagnostic equipment when I bring my car to the garage, and then they perform diagnostic, and maybe they change libraries, they update firmware, they can manipulate what is the asset inside the car, and then have effects that can go from safety to disruption to have an impact that can be various based on the different assets that they're going to fix, to exploit. So the idea here, it was really to give you not only the threats, but also the attack scenario, going a little step forward in order to understand, make you understand what is the problem, what are the issues at stake, and also to provide an initial list of good practice for all the car manufacturers, tier one, tier two, and aftermarket vendors, in order to really to bring everybody around the table and start to talk about what kind of cybersecurity action we can put in place to improve cybersecurity for smart cars, to work on information sharing, because this is something that we really need to do. For example, we started this year CarSec, which is the car cybersecurity expert group of ENISA, where we try to bring around the table all the cybersecurity in car automotive in Europe in order to understand what we can do as ENISA and how we can help. And also improve exchange between security researchers and third parties regarding disclosure of vulnerability, proof of concept, in order really to make together security. And then work on different aspects, which are not exactly technical, but organizational, like the liability of car manufacturer or component producer. What is the technical standard that should be used in Europe? What kind of evaluation scheme we should use to assess the security and the cybersecurity for automotive, and then how we can build tools together for cybersecurity analysis. So as I said, this study is going to be published in the coming months, and is part of our efforts on transport infrastructure. Another topic on transport infrastructure that we covered this year is regarding smart airports. I don't know if you have noticed, but lately airports are trying to enhance your passenger experience, trying to make more secure control, but at the same time giving you wayfinding services, applications, more information, real-time data regarding your change of plan, your layover, and about self-service check-in, all self-service security check. So the idea here was really to understand, because here we are talking about not the airport perimeter physical, but the interaction with the border control, with air traffic control, to really to understand what is the attack surface, from making this system, from making it smarter for the passenger. What does it mean from an attacker point of view? And as I said here, we go beyond the normal airport, because when you purchase a ticket at home, you start your trip much before. So when you access those web interfaces to book your ticket, and from them we have an entire set of vulnerabilities that are traditional for a web application to what is more related to airports that can be exploited. So the idea here was really to understand what are the assets, what are the threats that can cover the entire passenger experience, and help airport operators and all the stakeholders involved to minimize the attack surface, to minimize the possible exploits that can be used in this. So for this, as we did for the other studies, we cover the different threats, assets, and also here we define a list of possible attack scenarios that goes from the phishing attack to the airport administration, to jamming the communication between airplane and aircraft, to the tampering with the self-service e-ticketing system, creating fake passenger boarding pass, or compromising the baggage handling, so attacking the SCADA, and blocking the luggage. So imagine in a big airport, if we block the luggage delivery, what can happen? Or spoofing and jamming the communication between airplane and aircraft. So as you see, What we are trying to do is really to bring in the cybersecurity expertise vertical to each one of these infrastructure to tell people what are the threats and help them to mitigate them. Because up until now, most of these people, most operators of critical infrastructure or car manufacturer or airport, they didn't have cybersecurity in mind. This was not part of the game. So now we need to help them to understand what are the threats and how they can mitigate. So the idea here is really to help all the operators across the 28 different member states, which have different cybersecurity postures, to align and to have a common posture regarding cybersecurity. This is something that we are trying to do by modeling the threats for each sector, by working on the information sharing, by helping people to know each other, to bring them around the table, to discuss what kind of issue we have to face. Because if we want to go into this direction, we really need to work on cybersecurity, and we really need to work together. And we really need to develop skill set, because we really need to develop the next generation of cybersecurity experts, which have sectorial expertise for each one of the topics that I covered today. So, as I said, the goal of ENISA is really to propose recommendation to enhance cybersecurity. How we do this? We do by threat modeling the different sector. And we can speak because we have this unique point of view, both to security researchers, asset owners, policymakers, infrastructure operators, manufacturers and service providers, the Commission and the Member States. So we can really raise the issue of cybersecurity in the different assets. And we can promote collaboration. This is why we organize events. This is why we organize workshops. And this is why we are here today. Because we can promote collaboration across Europe. We try to promote cybersecurity by design into the business processes and to develop cybersecurity for safety. So integrate security for safety. But most of all, we understand that cybersecurity is a global effort, and this is why we want to get you involved. So how you can get involved, depending on your expertise on area of interest, because as I said, today I only give you an overview of what we do infrastructure security, but we cover the entire infrastructure and the entire cybersecurity panorama. You can engage us in studies. You can go to one of our events. So for example, if you're interested in ICS SCADA, next week we are in Stockholm. If you're interested in mobile attack and defense, we have something the 10th of November in Berlin, where in the morning we will talk about infrastructure and SS7 attacks, and in the afternoon we will talk about application security. We have CSIRT events. You could just have to go. We have e-health events. You just have to go on our website, and you will see all the events that we are going to do in the next 5 months. Or you can join one of our expert group. We have one about intelligent public transport, one about car security, regarding ICS and SCADA, and internet infrastructure. But we also have e-health, we have finance. So depending on what you are interested in, there is probably a reference group, a study, a topic, an event that we are going to organize. So just to wrap up, these are the upcoming studies. Today I just briefly cover some of them, so cars, SCADA, and airports, but we have also hospitals that is coming. We have an information exchange for electricity, we have power supply. So there is a lot of stuff to do. Everything we do is published in our annual work program, so you can already see on the work program what we are going to publish in the coming months. And we are discussing now what we are going to do next year. So just to wrap up, what we do in ENISA, well, exactly this. So we try to raise the bar of cybersecurity awareness in Europe. In my case, we work more on infrastructure. We work with the operator of critical infrastructure. We work with the core asset owners that can have an impact on the life of the citizen. We support private and public because we can really bring everybody around the table from different member states, from different kinds of stakeholders. We can try to bring everybody together and discuss what we can do to make better cybersecurity in Europe. We can facilitate information exchange and collaboration because not only we study, but we workshop meetings and events. And the idea here is really to foster the growth of communication network and industry because we cannot stop. this is going here and it's going to stay. The more we expose, the more we use communication, information communication technology, communication network, we go smart, the more we give attack surface to attackers, so the more we need to learn and to raise the bar of security. Because we really need to enable a higher level of information security in Europe if we want to have an European, Europe information society. So for this reason, in ENISA, we try really to be there, to be with the other, with all the stakeholders, to understand what are the needs, to publish a study that can help them in their everyday risk assessment, to go to their top managers and promote cybersecurity within the enterprise, and also to raise the level of awareness, to create opportunity for you to engage us with the exercise, the challenges, with the training, and also with the development of skill set, because as I said, we really need to raise the next generation of cybersecurity experts. So this was my one-on-one. I just give you, I think, 5 minutes for a question. I don't know if you have any question or if you need something. I will be here today. Consider that this, what I covered, was only one part. And if you need a specific need, just let me know, because probably I can put you in contact with one of our experts. So thanks a lot.
Any questions?
It's before lunch.
Lunchtime. Thank you very much, Rosella.